Thanks for joining us on the CBN News Channel. I'm Ephraim Graham.
And I'm Heather Sells. Intelligence officials in several countries have detected a plot to carry out a major coordinated series of commando-style terror attacks. They say this is a serious threat, and now they're scrambling to keep Al-Qaeda from striking. Charlene Israel has more.
Intelligence officials say new information point to credible terror threats. They just don't know where. France is on high alert after a caller issued a threat from a phone booth at the Eiffel Tower. It was the second time in 2 weeks the monument was shut down due to a terror threat. Intelligence and law enforcement officials in Europe and the U.S. warn of a major series of new terror attacks on Britain, France, Germany, and possibly the U.S. That's based on information gained from a captured suspected German jihadist. Officials say the captured German claimed that the attack had been personally approved by Osama bin Laden.
The American authorities are extremely nervous about what is going on. The Germans are extremely nervous about what is going on.
Officials say the new terror threats are coming from Pakistan. Officials are now looking for other radicalized Germans who may have been training in Pakistan for a commando-style raid similar to the attack on hotels in Mumbai, India, 2 years ago. In testimony before Congress last week, the head of the FBI testified about increased worries of new terror threats.
Despite the significant counterterrorism pressure abroad, Al-Qaeda continues to be committed to high-profile attacks directed at the West, including plans against Europe, as well as the homeland.
Meanwhile, the U.S. continues to take the fight to Al-Qaeda's home turf. Pakistan is trying to confirm reports that a senior Al-Qaeda commander was killed in a CIA missile strike. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Charlene, thank you. Heavy fighting is underway in Kandahar, Afghanistan, a major stronghold and the birthplace of the Taliban. U.S. and Afghan forces are in the middle of a major combat offensive. Military reporter Chuck Holton is in Afghanistan with the troops. He tells us they're ready for a fight.
The troops, when I was here 5 months ago, were very downhearted, and that was because they were not being allowed to go after the enemy. They were having what was called a tactical pause. But since General Petraeus has taken over, the pace of operations definitely has ramped up, not just in Kandahar, but around the country. And that has brought the morale back of the troops. It's very high now. They really feel like they're making a difference, and they want to stay here and see the job get done.
Chuck also tells us since the U.S. began engaging the enemy, more Afghan men are signing up to join the Army and National Police.
President Obama wraps up a four-day tour today with stops in Des Moines, Iowa, and Richmond, Virginia. Tuesday, he spoke at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, a liberal stronghold. He's trying to reignite the enthusiasm of his 2008 drive to the White House.
The stakes are too high for our country and for your future, and I am going to get out there and fight as hard as I can, and I know you are too.
Although two-thirds of young voters supported Obama in 2008, the enthusiasm has cooled this year. In an interview with Rolling Stone magazine, the president told Democrats to wake up. And this week, the vice president told the base to, quote, stop whining and buck up. Some Democrats say this approach could backfire.
He is telling voters on the Democratic base that they are irresponsible, that, you know, they're slackers, that they don't care enough to show up.
A famed Washington journalist is shedding new light on what goes on behind the scenes in the Obama administration. Bob Woodward's new book is called Obama Wars. The book exposes the president butting heads with military leaders over Afghanistan, giving warnings to Pakistan and saying about the U.S., quote, we can absorb a terrorist attack. Joining us now with more is Dr. Charles Dunn, distinguished professor of government at Regent University. Now, you say allowing Woodward into the White House is like letting a chicken into the hen house. How so? A fox into the hen house, I should say. How so?
Every president that has allowed Bob Woodward into the White House has not come away unscathed. In one way or another, they've looked bad. And this is true now with President Obama. He looks bad. He looks weak. He looks like he has an administration that lacks discipline. So a lot of things in this book reveal that President Obama is in difficulty. It's like Murphy's Law. If anything can go wrong, it will go wrong. And just when President Obama was really hoping that he could turn things around, Bob Woodward's book comes out, making him look bad.
Wow, just in advance of the midterm elections
yes.
as well. Would you say the book is damaging to the president or even the war effort?
It's damaging not so much and how we're prosecuting the war as it is damaging to the president's image. Expectations are very important in politics. Expectations of how a president behaves. And what Bob Woodward develops is the expectations of a president who lacks control over his administration. He allows too much leeway for people like Rahm Emanuel and Joe Biden to sound off. Mm-hmm. And we know Vice President Biden many times has sounded off. And that sends a signal that he doesn't control the administration like he should.
What other things do you think this reveals about how he runs government?
Well, he is, by background, a professor and a legislator. He's had no executive experience. We do what we know. What does he know? He knows being a professor. He knows being a legislator. He doesn't know being an executive. So he doesn't understand that you, as president of the United States, must make difficult and demanding decisions and timely decisions, create a vision for the American public and for everybody around you, and then rally the troops to get behind that vision. By contrast, take Ronald Reagan. He created a vision. The people in America bought into the vision. He was able to move the Congress just overnight with a speech to the nation. Whereas President Obama, when he gives a speech to the nation from the Oval Office, he comes off as weak. Now, here's a fellow who drew huge crowds during the campaign. 200,000 in Germany, 70,000 in Denver. So what do we have is a person who doesn't demonstrate the passion and the vision for the American public to follow.
Now, saying that, when the president was campaigning, we pretty much understood his message. Do you think he's doing a good job of controlling the message now that's coming from his administration?
Well, the problem was the message itself, change and hope. Well, what does that mean? And he promised that, but then what did he do with regard to health care? He turned that over to Speaker Pelosi and Senator Reid and Democratic majorities. He didn't have an overall umbrella theme. The great presidents to illustrate, Franklin Roosevelt, New Deal, Harry Truman, Fair Deal. So you had an overall umbrella theme, and they sent to the Congress what they wanted. President Obama did not send to the Congress what he wanted and didn't have an overall theme for it.
All right, Dr. Dunn, thank you so much for being with us. Good insight, as always.
Recent polls show many Americans still believe President Obama is a Muslim, but Tuesday he stated once again that he is a Christian. He was out in Albuquerque, New Mexico, for a relaxed outdoor roundtable when a woman in the crowd asked him about his faith.
I'm a Christian by choice. The precepts of Jesus Christ spoke to me in terms of the kind of life that I would want to lead. And I think also understanding that that Jesus Christ dying for my sins spoke to the humility we all have to have as human beings, that we're sinful and we're flawed and we make mistakes, and that we achieve salvation through the grace of God.
President Obama pointed out that America is a predominantly Christian nation, but he said Jews, Muslims, Hindus, atheists, agnostics, and Buddhists all have their own path to grace.
Religion may be a big part of our society, but a new survey shows most Americans cannot answer basic questions about their religion or other religions. On average, Americans got a 50 on the quiz, and Christians had some of the worst grades. Dale Hurd has more.
In the survey by the Pew Forum on Religion and Public Life, respondents were asked about different religions, including whether they could name the Islamic Holy Book, the first book of the Bible, as well as questions about Eastern religions. Greg Smith is with the Pew Forum on Religion and Public Life.
The questions were designed to sort of cover the landscape. We wanted to find out what people know about their own faiths and about other religions.
Based on 32 questions about all religions, atheists and agnostics, Jews and Mormons got more answers right than Protestants and Roman Catholics. On questions about Christianity and the Bible, Mormons scored the highest, with an average of about 8 correct answers out of 12. followed by white evangelicals with an average of just over 7 correct answers. Atheists and agnostics knew more about Christianity than black Protestants and white Catholics. Only 46% of Protestants could identify Martin Luther as the person who inspired the Protestant Reformation. Only 11% knew that Jonathan Edwards participated in the First Great Awakening.
And something like 3/4 of Protestants are unable to identify Protestantism as the faith, not Catholicism, that teaches that salvation comes through faith alone.
Surveys have long showed that Bible literacy has been falling among Americans and among evangelicals.
Can you name 3 of the 10 commandments for me?
Nope.
Can you name 1 of the 10 commandments for me?
Nope.
Can you name the first book of the Bible?
Testament.
The Pew survey found that those with the highest church attendance and those with the highest level of education got the most answers right. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
And still to come, restoring holiness in the church. You hear one woman's call for God's people to return to biblical living.
Powerful songs of our time.
Come, now is the time to worship.
And now, for the first time, the biggest praise and worship songs are together.
How great is our God.
Presenting Songs for Worship 50. 50 songs in one specially priced collection.
Holy is the Lord.
You'll hear 50 beautiful songs of hope.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's
50 powerful songs of faith.
Amazing love, how can it be?
Get Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for only
$24.99. Here I am for worship. Here I am.
But wait. Order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll take $15 off. That's right. You get 50 praise and worship songs for just
$9.99.
Then preview other great praise and worship collections. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So call now and get Songs for Worship 50. 50 beautiful songs on 3 CDs for just
$9.99.
Call 1-800-435-3414 to order Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you use your credit card. Call now or order online at timelife.com/songsforworship50.
From divorce to sexual sins to addictions, the church in America has made headlines for not living up to God's call to righteousness. So what exactly is missing?
For more on this, Charlene Israel spoke with author Thelma Smith. She's been in ministry with her husband for 30 years, and she's written the new book, A Bride Without Spot or Wrinkle, Prayers of Restoration and Transformation for the Body of Christ.
First of all, what inspired you to write this book?
Well, I would have to say God inspired me to write this book through Isaiah chapter 62. In that chapter, he talks about, it's Isaiah's prayer for the church. And he says, I will not stop praying for Zion. Mm-hmm. Because I love Zion, I will not stop praying for her until her beauty shines forth as the dawn, like a blazing torch. And it goes on to say that the church is God's bride.
Excellent. So how do you think God is actually preparing the body of Christ to be that beautiful bride without a spot or wrinkle?
Well, certainly God does much of the work, but we have our part in it. We are to pray. Mm-hmm. In the Old Testament, prophets prayed, even though things were prophesied to come to pass. For example, Nehemiah prayed for the restoration of Jerusalem before he actually led in the rebuilding of the wall and the city. Daniel prayed for Jerusalem. They'd been in captivity for 70 years, and he'd read the prophecies, and he knew it was time for the deliverance of Israel. But he prayed for that to happen, and so we have an obligation to pray.
Now, you write in your book about God's relationship to the church and how that parallels marriage. Talk a little bit about that real quick.
Yes. Well, in Ephesians chapter 5, God talks about the relationship between the husband and the wife and how that really represents the bride, the church, and Jesus Christ. It represents that relationship. And it is important that people realize the parallel that God makes here in Scripture. There are many things that are reflected in Scripture that in the natural that are actually spiritual concepts.
How is the most important way we can be praying? Real quick, we're running out of time, but to be praying, you lay some prayer targets out in the book.
Yes, I do. Yes. Well, in the beginning, when God, when the fall took place, there were some curses that were placed on the man and the woman. And praying specifically against those curses.
Against those curses.
That we're free from now because of the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That is what we need to be praying against those curses.
Excellent. Thank you so much for sharing with us. And it is called A Bride Without Spot or Wrinkle. And this is available.
It's available where books are sold. At wherever books are sold.
Amen. Thelma Smith, thanks for joining us. Really appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
It's been 8 months since Haiti was rocked by a devastating earthquake, and the struggling country still has not seen any of the financial support the U.S. promised. The $1 billion pledge is tied up in Washington. Government officials say the problem is bureaucracy, disorganization, and a lack of urgency. Meanwhile, more than a million Haitians still live on the streets between piles of rubble.
Up next, how a radical Muslim group may have found an open door into the halls of power in America.
To sing some praise.
Jesus, be evident.
Get ready to put your hands together. Time Life presents Shouting Down the Aisles, today's best traditional gospel.
You ought to let go and let God have it away.
30 foot stomping, hand clapping classics.
Long as I got King Jesus. Long as I got King Jesus. Long as I got him.
Don't need nobody else. Lord, that's my tribulation. Lord, that's
get Shouting Down the Aisles on two CDs for just $24.99. But wait, order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll cut the price to just $14.99.
I gotta clean up what I messed up.
That's right, you'll clean up with two CDs, 30 songs for just
$14.99.
Then preview other great gospel CDs. Satisfaction guaranteed.
I'm a soldier.
Special collection is not sold in stores. So call now and start shouting down the aisles with two CDs for just
$14.99.
Call 1-800-366-4691 to order Shouting Down the Aisles on two CDs for $14.99 plus shipping and handling when you call in the next 10 minutes with your credit card. Or order online at timelife.com/shout.
Al-Qaeda may not be the biggest threat to America from radical Islam. Some experts believe a group called the Muslim Brotherhood poses a more significant long-term threat.
Like Al-Qaeda, this global organization is committed to establishing Islamic Sharia law. The Brotherhood has several affiliates in the U.S. One of the most visible is a group called CARE. CBN's Eric Stackelback discussed all this with a roundtable of experts on his new program, Stackelback on Terror. Here are some of the highlights.
I want to pick up, John, with a group called the Council on American Islamic Relations, CARE. Now, we've talked about this whole alphabet soup of Muslim Brotherhood connected American Islamic groups. CARE may be the most notorious. Talk a little bit about them, and then we want to get into how CARE and these groups have infiltrated the halls of power here in America.
Well, I think I would actually start with that is when you think about it, how is it possible that all these things have happened? How is it possible that the man who founded the Muslim chaplain program for the Department of Defense is an Al-Qaeda operative and now in jail for 23 years for that and being involved in a plot to kill the Saudi crown prince with Al-Qaeda operatives?
And his name is?
Abdurrahman Al-Amoudi.
And he had an open door in the Clinton and Bush White Houses, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, he did.
An Al-Qaeda operative.
An Al-Qaeda operative.
Interesting.
You've got, how is it that, you know, the very first Muslim to offer prayers in U.S. Congress, Siraj Wahaj, is an unindicted co-conspirator in the 93 World Trade Center bombing. And the list goes on and on. How is it possible that one of the senior Hamas leaders in America is now the human rights commissioner for Jacksonville, Florida?
These guys are mainstream, is what you're saying. These guys are mainstream now.
And they're
Islamic
terrorists.
Radicals are mainstream. And
they're terrorists. These aren't just Muslim brothers. I mean, these guys are terrorists. These guys are involved in terrorist plots or leading terrorist groups. When we talk about CARE, what you need to understand, there are a few key facts. Number one, they are co-conspirators in the Holy Land Foundation after massive amounts of evidence.
And we discussed that trial,
right.
2007, 2008.
Right.
Largest terrorism financing trial in American history.
Yes.
CARE and this whole alphabet soup of Islamic groups we're discussing were named as unindicted co-conspirators in that trial.
Several of them were. Certainly ISNA, Nate, and CARE, and CARE's leader, Omar Ahmad, was a named unindicted co-conspirator as well. And it wasn't because they weren't unindicted because they were innocent. They weren't indicted because there were over 200 individuals and organizations that should be prosecuted.
So, Patrick, let me get this straight. John says CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations, they're Muslim Brotherhood, they are Hamas.
And what's...
How are they getting... Sorry to cut you off, but how is this group able to ingratiate themselves in the halls of power? This group CARE is quoted by the Associated Press, quoted by CNN, as a moderate voice of Islam. They've been guests at the White House. Department of Homeland Security Chief Janet Napolitano meets with them. How's this happen?
That's an excellent question, and CARE is certainly the most visible of these Muslim Brotherhood front groups. They're the organization that probably most of your viewers see. They see Ibrahim Hooper, they see Nahad Awad on CNN and Fox News and all these other organizations, and they're really the propaganda front for the whole apparatus, for the Muslim Brotherhood network.
Do you think the government knows, Brian? Do you think our government officials know? And they just, is it willful blindness, as our friend Andy McCarthy wrote? Do they know and just look the other way on purpose?
It can only be that they know, because this information, we're not like, this isn't a scoop right here. Right.
Yeah, we're
this
not divulging top secret information here.
This information
it's all out there.
Has been around for the last 10
Google
years.
Search, right? LexisNexis.
And one of the most insidious things about CARE is that they force their will on the system. And they will go up against police departments that are doing anything about this problem, and they will then, you know, take the police departments to task, and, you know, eventually they'll be invited in to teach police officers what Islam and everything is all about. And these guys are the bad guys. They're the bad guys teaching police departments.
And do they have an open door in this administration?
Oh, certainly. And the consequence of that is that the government is mainstreaming the radical element in all these institutions and granting them legitimacy.
Do they believe that they're moderate? Does the government believe these guys are moderate?
I can't answer that, but clearly from the evidence, they're not.
Of course.
But they give these groups legitimacy when they invite them in. Well, I can't be a Hamas supporter because I just met with Valerie Jarrett over at the White House
exactly.
the other day.
Exactly.
And you can watch more of Eric Stackelbeck on Terror Show at our website, cbnnews.com. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Introducing Easy Combs, the easy new way to create dazzling new do's. Simply slide in one end, stretch it around your hair, and slide in on the other side for an updo that's brand new. Or fluff it out for a fountain effect. Look again. The bungee band stretch and release for a relaxed custom fit every time. Liven up a ponytail or create this amazing butterfly twist. It's great for short hair and ideal for the office. It's perfect for any formal occasion. Ouch, claw clips hurt. But Easy Combs are soft and comfortable, so easy to use, kids love them too. Now get Easy Combs in caramel bronze for only $10. Call now and get one in dazzling silver. As a special bonus, get our Bermuda black plus a styling DVD. Just pay separate shipping and handling. With a step-by-step DVD, Easy Combs are a cinch. You get caramel, silver, and black plus the style guide and DVD, a $60 value, all for only $10.
Call 1-800-520-1486. You'll get the bonus Easy Combs as advertised when you call 1-800-520-1486.
Love to shop for shoes, but there's no place to store them? You're always running out of room to store more. Introducing Shoes Under, the easy solution to organize and protect your shoes. The clear zipper cover locks out dust and moisture. Now you just slide and store. It's that easy. With two handles, you can easily store your shoes here, under there, almost everywhere, and turn an empty space into a super storage place. Other shoe organizers can cost a fortune, but through this exclusive television offer, you can get the 12-compartment Shoes Under for only $19.99. Call now and we'll cut that price in half. That's right, for only $10. And as a bonus, we'll double the offer and give you a second Shoes Under that's enough space for 48 shoes. Just pay separate shipping and handling. Call now and get two Shoes Under for only $10.
Call 1-800-943-1652. You'll get a second one free, so call 1-800-943-1652. That's 1-800-943-1652. Call now.
And finally today, a touchdown at a high school football game is usually not a big deal.
But watch what happened when a player with Down syndrome got the ball at a game in Washington State.
Here's the quarterback. They're going to give it to him, and they're going to run the football, and they're going to come through. They're going to miss him with one tackle. Still on the run around the left-hand side. He's going to be missed with a second man. Now, did he go out of bounds? No, he's still on the field. He's still running down the field, but they're still trying to chase him. Are they going to let him score a touchdown, or they're going to make a stop? As Lake Stevens is still chasing him, they've got a cordon of players around him. They're going to head all the way down into the end zone for a snow homage touchdown by Ike Ditzenberger.
Two rival teams worked together to allow Ike Ditzenberger to score the only touchdown of the night for his team. The opposing team faked missed tackles to give the 17-year-old a 51-yard run that took 10 seconds. Ike's team still lost, but it was the game of his dreams. So pretty amazing that some high schoolers would do that for their teammate.
They're all winners there for sure.
Right.
That is going to do it for this hour of the CBN News Channel. Remember, you can find information on all the stories you've seen here at cbnnews.com.
And you can also stay up to date with CBN News through Facebook and Twitter. We hope you'll join us next time. Have a great day.
SuperbookKids.com. We created this website as a place where kids can learn the Bible in a whole new way.
Kids will love SuperbookKids.com. They're games, the ability to create your own personal Superbook characters. We even have a place for kids to listen to music on Superbook Radio.
Superbook is CBN's animated series that teaches the Bible through the eyes of two friends and their robot sidekick. We're going to tell stories all the way from creation to Christ's return.
The website also teaches kids life lessons. Parents can spend time online with their kids learning about the Bible.
SuperbookKids.com is entirely gospel-centered, and by supporting it, you'll help bring God's Word to children all over the world.
SuperbookKids.com. We're reaching a new generation with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Together, we can give today's kids the truth of the Bible in a fun and exciting way that will change their lives.
The secret kingdom is pertinent. It's pertinent for today and what you're going through.
He's showing us to step out of our comfort zone and receive what God has given us to be able to move forward in life.
Motivates me now to have bigger faith
not just a small faith, but bigger faith to believe that God will do what he said he'll do.
This is not one of those DVDs you want to leave in your glove box and you want to sit on a table. This is a DVD you want to wear out.
Your life can be absolutely transformed